Welcome to the latest episode of The Bold Truth About Hungary, our podcast, which is available at my Twitter account. Please follow us, and please welcome today's special guest, who is Miklós Szánthó, the Director General of the Center for Fundamental Rights. Most importantly, he is the father of the Hungarian CPAC. The ideas, the yeah, idea behind
one of the founding
the idea behind the Hungarian CPAC probably originated from you, and the reason actually we are talking about we are having this discussion today is that within maybe a week we are going to have another CPAC here in Hungary. I wanted to start our conversation today from a perspective which is suggesting that CPAC, at least today, this year's CPAC, is not standing alone. Something is happening in Hungary, with a special regard to the visit of Pope Francis the upcoming weekend. Tell us something about what's going on in Hungary. What is this conservative renaissance? What is this reawakening that is going around among politicians, political ideologies, and individuals who are considered by the so-called progressives, I think that's the proper word they are using for themselves,
as outdated. I usually call them neo-Marxists, but let's say progressives.
We are going to come back to this, okay. But let's talk about progressivism from the perspective, as they or most of the time call out, conservatism as an outdated, old idea that has no validity at all for the future of Europe, but as a matter of fact, global politics.
Thank you very, very much for having me, first of all. Today's progressives would like to cancel everything, cancel history and cancel conservatives and traditional values as well, in general. But back to your original point or question, I think that Hungary, and including the Hungarian right, the Hungarian conservatives, we do punch way above our official weight or official position. Hungary, from a political point of view, have become some kind of a lighthouse or powerhouse for conservatives all over the world. And it's mirrored by CPAC Hungary as well, but of course it's not only about CPAC Hungary, and it's not about us, it's not about the Center for Fundamental Rights, it's about the Hungarian right as a community, as a collective political group. And I think here we should underline or highlight the fact that yes, the past 12 or 13 years in Hungary, from a conservative perspective, is a success story. And it resonates to the mindset of our conservative friends in the West as well. And they do feel, and I think they also know that Hungary is not only a lighthouse or a powerhouse for this conservative renaissance, but Budapest and Hungary is the hub for conservatives to come together, to share ideas, to change or exchange recipes for conservative success, as Prime Minister Orbán shared the 12-point recipe of conservative success at CPAC Hungary. So it's very visible that although Hungary is a, let's say, a middle-sized country, and it's not officially not that important from a political or geopolitical point of view, but if it comes to political know-how, if it comes to political knowledge, it's very clear that, of course, we should learn from our friends from all over the world how they do their conservative policies and politics in their respective countries, but I really feel that they, our friends from the West, from the conservative international family, would like to learn from us nowadays how to do politics. And it's a very important factor in success, because as I begin my answer, Hungary this shows that Hungary punches way above its weight, because it's not normal that a Hungary-sized country can teach other ones in the conservative hemisphere.
Very much so, and I recall what the Prime Minister said last time, and that is last year, that many argue, as a matter of fact, our arch enemies argue that conservatives by origin or by nature don't really unite. Of course, they do know, because they, as internationalists, are having a different agenda, but I'm going to come back to this. And the Prime Minister suggested that instead of concentrating on that, and that is what is separating conservatives, for obvious reasons, for the perspective on their own national identity, national histories, own economic innate needs and interests, let's find the common ground, let's find those common elements actually in our policies, which are growing in numbers, let's put it that way, on which we can build and on which we can elaborate. But I wanted to come back to one element actually, which obviously unites us, and that is cancel culture you just mentioned. For many, cancel culture seems to be a new phenomenon, a novelty. But we all know that it is not. At least I'm a historian, and I know that I've seen that before. And I've seen that back in the 1950s, when the first wave of communism, after the Soviet Union occupied half of Europe and started to export its ideology, basically has introduced already cancel culture and wanted to change everything. Cancel history, cancel the social institutions, cancel religion, for instance. Social institutions, I mean the family, all those traditional elements of civil society, actually, which are the building blocks of any conservative idea and association. So this is a renaissance of cancel culture in its modern form, let's put it that way, against which more and more are speaking out.
Yeah, I totally agree. You can call it woke, you can call it cancel culture, you can call it political correctness. This liberal progressive madness is more or less the same in every and each country, not in the world, but in the Western civilization nowadays. This is a very important phenomenon. I will come back to this. But what you mentioned, that your comparison with communism, liberals always become very angry if they hear that this very polite and generous liberal idea is compared to a totalitarian ideology like communism. But to tell the truth, the new mask, the new face of communism is this progressive liberalism nowadays. That is why I told you a few minutes earlier that I usually call them neo-Marxists, because you've got your point. Communists intended to cancel God, to cancel homeland, and to cancel family. And that is the very intention of the liberals, of the progressives, nowadays as well. Of course, they are speaking about tolerance and in a very positive way, and paying attention to the sensitiveness of other different groups. On a daily basis, they invent new and new identity groups nowadays. But in general, what are they doing? They are trying to cancel history. And to cancel history in Europe and in the Western civilization, it means to cancel our Jewish, Christian, cultural heritage. With this whole blah blah about open borders and about multiculturalism, the intention is to cancel nationhood, to cancel national identity and national history, national heroes as well. Although it was far away from us, but this whole BLM movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, and its outcome was the very physical institutionalization of this cancel culture, because they tear down different statues. They began to urge for renaming, relabeling different books, different institutions, universities, because as they try to argue those institutions and those books and those even social institutions mirror the toxic heritage of white heterosexual men in this culture. And at the end of the story, and the end of the day, with this whole gender ideology, they would like to cancel family as well, or as they call it, to deconstruct the family. But as a boomerang effect, and this is where we should say a thank you for the liberals, because this trend, this approach, this attack is so broad, so deep, so huge, and so aggressive that it causes a boomerang effect. And it unites conservatives really all over the world, all over the Western civilization, because they feel this woke insanity in Sao Paulo, in Mexico City, in Washington, D.C., in Paris, in Rome, and in Budapest as well. So, in some way, the liberals helped us to find or to localize our very fundamental values. And in a way, as conservatives from the US, from Brazil, from France, from Italy, from Hungary, feel that this massive attack from the progressives is global, then we should step up, we conservatives should step up globally against this this mainstream. And this is reflected in the motto of CPAC Hungary, this year's CPAC Hungary, because the motto is United We Stand.
This is very interesting because, again, one, if not charge, but argument has always been that the before mentioned reasons, and that is that conservatives are divided by nature, it is almost impossible to unite. And one recognition for years by now actually was that, yes, indeed, in face of that, we have to demonstrate that there are reasons and possibilities to unite. Do you believe that the reasons behind uniting, the reasons behind coming together, having these kind of discussions in the United States, in Japan, in Hungary, and probably in other parts of the globe very soon, are due to, or could be thanked to, the fact that the self-defense mechanisms of society are being triggered by those extremist approaches of this woke, cancel, abolish culture we are talking about? As we have witnessed for the past couple of years, it is not simply, or not anymore, the liberal zealotness, let's put it that way, which is about liberating, freeing social groups, animals, whichever part of the globe from oppression, as they say, but it is becoming a religion, an obsessive religion, which basically carries all the attributes of a religion without values. And we've been discussing it actually again for years and years behind us, that this is a valueless religion and worldview, which the liberals are trying to suggest to us, and that is equating everything, making everything equal, not only by rights, but basically abolishing contrast in society between individuals, individual capabilities, color, and so on, talking about these things as unnatural, are going to backlash, and that is result in some kind of resistance, let's put it that way, which eventually can unite or can bring in the factors that can unite conservatives around the globe.
Yeah, one of their very important tool or mechanism is making everything equal. The another one is making everything relative. They say that there is no good and bad. Everything is relative, subjective, and as a result, you cannot evaluate things. You cannot say that there's something is valuable and something is not valuable. But the very thing is that it's not only a political debate, or it's not a debate between ideologies. First of all, because conservatism, I think, is not an ideology, it's rather a habit or a worldview, while most of those or all of those socialistic, progressive behaviors or ideas, like socialism, communism, and including progressive liberalism, those are ideologies. And ideologies usually become dogmas as well. But my point is that this whole debate about God, homeland, and family is not about ideology. It's about common sense. It's about our everyday way of life. And that's why I'm quite, if the question or if the topic is about how it will end, I'm quite optimistic. Because, of course, with political communication, with PR activities, with campaigns, with propaganda, you can sensitize people, as they call it, sensitization. I think it's brainwashing, but let's use sensitization. But if this whole thing will come to, and it's already approaching to common sense, our usual, normal way of life, if it comes to our children, then I do really believe that most of the people will refuse, and not because of political beliefs, but because they will, or they already feel, that this whole thing is against nature, is against created order, it is against the Western way of life. Because of course you can propagate open borders, you can make some propaganda for canceling this toxic history of ours. But I think the red line is, or the red line was, this whole gender ideology. This whole thing that with gender ideology, they targeted the children, the minors. And at the end of the day, this will be the turning point, because like in Hungary, people would like, that's the way of life. People would like to have children, people would like to raise their children, because that is the future. That is why we are living on the first. And it's a totally normal parental reflect that if someone would like to touch your children verbally or physically, then you defend your children. So I think the liberals, it was a very bad an amoral political move from their point of view, that they began this sensitization with gender ideology targeting the minors.
Very much so, and probably that's going to be one of the symbolic elements, actually, of symbolic examples of those fields or measures by which we can demonstrate or show how this common sense, practical, pragmatic approach to our lives is being perceived by us. And when you were referring to the example of Hungary, I believe behind us over the past 10 years is a series of, and a set of, not simply ideas, but decisions and executed decisions by which we can demonstrate that, yes, it is possible by a common sense, conservative reasoning to implement socially, not simply justifiable, but useful and workable ideas on the ground. We've seen already announced speakers on your website. My feeling is that this kind of common sense approach is bringing together conservative mindset people, not only from conservative parties by now. Do you believe that this is a prospect of future for the conservative idea itself, that politic-wise or party-wise, is going to open up the conservative possibilities in parties that, in their names or by their affiliation, is not, associated with center-right conservative movements? This is my impression from the list of invitees and speakers, actually, at this year's event.
Yeah, I brought common sense to the topic to show you and show to the audience that it's this whole debate is not between or about ideologies, and CPAC Hungary will not be only about ideologies, but about common sense and political practice. And I've already seen several comments on the internet from the left saying that this year CPAC Hungary will be a no star event, so an event without stars. On the other hand, on a daily basis, I see also media reports from the left about CPAC Hungary, that CPAC Hungary this year will be some kind of a super gathering of right-wing fascists in Budapest. So it's a real intellectual challenge to see the real point in the argumentation of the left. But I would advise to stay with or at the facts. What we will have at CPAC Hungary is two sitting prime ministers, two ex-prime ministers, four party chairmen from Europe, two congressmen from the US, two ex and future senators, two ministers from the states of the United States of America, one from Texas, one from Indiana, and several politicians, representatives, members of parliaments from Europe and from all over the world. And back to your real point of your question, yes, it is this whole conservative mindset. It's a very good word, I think, to represent this phenomenon. The conservative mindset is much more broader than the spectrum of these conservative political parties as well. So, for example, we will have Andrei Babiš from the Czech Republic, who is the chairman or president of the party ANO, which is officially member of Renew Europe, which is a liberal progressive party family in general in Europe. But I wouldn't blame. So Andrei Babiš is a very pragmatic and very wise, common sense based right. gentleman, and he will join CPAC Hungary as well. Or on the other hand, the Prime Minister of Georgia, Irakli Garibashvili, will join us as well, whose party is officially the member of the European Socialist Party, an observing member. But the Georgian Prime Minister as well is a common sense based guy who would like to defend the Christian traditions of his country, would like to defend the Georgian nationhood and countryhood, and would like to protect the family and the Georgian children. So that's why I mentioned a few minutes earlier that thanks to the liberals, we always knew that our core values is the triune of God, homeland, and family. But as we see it, that these triune values are attacked on a daily basis so massively and so aggressively, more and more conservative mindsets realize that in order to protect our societies, our nations, our families and our children, we should step up globally. And this joint cooperation is not linked directly to formal party affiliation.
Very well. And I myself personally very much appreciate the opportunity actually to utilize on the speakers and the participants actually of CPAC, because the plan is that the upcoming week and during CPAC, we are going to have a couple of conversations with these members actually participants of CPAC. We are going to come back to many ideas actually, I believe, next week too.
I hope so as well.
Let's conclude this conversation this time about the future, because very obviously, when you organize an event like CPAC Hungary. As I see, this is going to happen usually in May, which is a very good date and time of the year, actually, from the perspective of politics. What are the future plans? We've seen CPAC Hungary coming to the US last year, which obviously was a demonstration of the quality of Hungary's CPAC, and that is the recognition in the home of CPAC, which is the United States. How do you wish to proceed? What are the plans for the future?
It's up to God, first of all. So, of course, we would like to have CPAC next year again. It's bad news for my colleagues because they are working a lot with this this year as well. But the general plan, and this again, it's not about CPAC. It's not about CPAC Hungary. The general plan is to realize the nightmare. First of all. Is to realize the nightmare of the liberals, to organize the international cooperation of right-wing national forces. Secondly, and it's a homework for us, for international conservatives or conservatives at the international level, is to converge or align our potentially or possibly different geopolitical argumentation with our fight for our commonly shared values. Because I think if it comes to the geopolitical level, for example, the war in the Ukraine, the strategy is the very same. All of us would like to see a sovereign, independent Ukraine, and none of us would like to live in the shadows of a possible Russian threat. There are different geopolitical views or tools how to reach this situation, but I think we could overcome those differences. And meanwhile, while we are trying to discuss the thing, we should keep in mind that there are much more that unites us than that divides us. Of course, we should not do the liberals the favor that we concentrate on those things that divide us. So my point is that the most important thing that on the long run, those issues about God, homeland, and the family will be the most important ones for our societies. And of course, we should be wise and we should be clever at the geopolitical and the geostrategic level. But this should not influence our international cooperation. And as CPAC Hungary is not the only one or not the exclusive, but one of the flagship projects for this international cooperation of conservatives. CPAC Hungary will show that united we stand. First of all, that we can go against the liberal mainstream together. And secondly, of course, that the strategy and the argumentation of Hungarian conservatives and the Hungarian right about the needed situation of peace and connectivity has a lot of friends all around the world.
And I believe common sense is going to help overcome any of the ideological overpassing, overclashes actually in opinion. And if any believe that we have omitted the topic of war for political intentions, I can make you sure that it is going to come back because obviously it's going to be a topic on CPAC and the discussions. And my plan is to come back and discuss it after CPAC in the light of those discussions actually we are going to have.
Just one last point. The Hungarian right is usually blamed of being some kind of anti-American political standpoint. But no, we do have a lot of friends of the US. CPAC Hungary is a symbol that the Hungarian right is in that way pro-American, and we have a lot of allies in the US as well, allies who do share our standpoint about peace. One of the greatest stars on the stage of CPAC Hungary will be Carrie Lake, who is a rising star in the US. He ran for governor of Arizona, and she will run for senator to the Senate, and possibly she will be the vice presidential candidate for President Trump. She will be here. And just a few months ago at the American CPAC in Washington, D.C., she held a speech. And in that speech, she argued the very same as the Hungarian conservatives and as the Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban. She argued that this Ukrainian war is not our war. We need peace and we need immediate ceasefire. And I think it is the Hungarian standpoint, and visibly it is the standpoint of many US conservatives.
And we've seen that initiative coming in the US Congress already, as a matter of fact. So, all right, let's leave it here for the moment. Thank you, Miklós. And I believe I would close with the remark that, yes, indeed, building a narrative which is intended to counter-resist actually the narrative, the very swiping narrative of the liberal progressive political mindset against the conservative mindset, indeed is in need of being built and reinforced. I believe and I hope that the bold truth about Hungary as a podcast is can be instrumental in that, because keep in mind that, as we always suggest, that we always say what we mean and we always mean what we say. And I believe not only the bold truth of about Hungary, but also CPAC Hungary is going to be instrumental on that for the future. Thank you for today's discussion.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me.